Bam, Mr. Tarrou. In this video, we're going to continue our discussion of sequences in precalculus with the introduction of an arithmetic sequence. It's a special type. We're going to learn two types in the next couple of videos. An arithmetic sequence is a sequence in which each term after the first term differs from the preceding term by a constant amount or difference. They're very, very easy to spot this pattern, and they show up so often that we're going to end this initial board by discussing a formula to help you set up the general term or the general form of an arithmetic sequence. But first, let's just take a look at this example. We've got an example, a sub 1, a sub 2, and a sub 3 and 4. We have the values of 2, 11, 20, and 29. So let's just look at what we got here. A sub 1, the first term in our sequence, is equal to 2, and D, our common difference, you know, what are we constantly adding or subtracting by? Well, 11 minus 2 is 9. 20 minus 11 is 9, and 29 minus 20 is equal to 9. So we have a list of numbers, a sequence of numbers, and this is written as finite because I don't have any dot, dot, dots, or it can go continuously, where you recognize that as you subtract each pair of numbers, a sub 4 minus a sub 3, a sub 3 minus a sub 2, and so on, that you continually get this common difference of 9. So when you find a sequence of values, you're constantly adding or subtracting by the same number, you are dealing with an arithmetic sequence. We're going to come up with two formulas now, two versions of, well, not versions, but two formulas or expressions that will create the numbers in the sequence for us. The first type is the recursion formula. We've talked about this in the previous video. It's a pattern, it's a combination of two formulas, and recursion formulas are very, very easy to come up with. Their only problem is, if you want the 10th term, you have to start at the first one and work through all the first 9 before you get to that 10th term and you actually figure it out. Then we're going to talk about a general term, which will allow us to go right to that 10th term or any term in the sequence we like immediately, skipping all the preceding values or terms. A recursion formula, well, recursion formulas have two parts. There's an a sub 1 formula, and then there's an a sub n formula. So a recursion formula, I mean, just look what we have here. The first term in the sequence is equal to 2, so a sub 1 is equal to 2. And then a recursion formula allows you to define every term in the sequence by doing something with the preceding term. Like, how do I find 11? I add 9 to 2. How do I find 20? I add 9 to 11. How do I find 29? Well, I'm simply just adding by 9. So my second formula in the recursion formula is going to be a sub n equals a sub n minus 1, notation to say, okay, you want the third one, go to the second one. If you want the fifth term, go to the fourth term. Just go to the preceding term in the sequence, and then just add 11 to it, and you're done. See, I started 2 and add by, not 11, but add by 9. Okay. Boom, done. But again, if I want the 10th term with this setup, I have to go through all of the preceding 9 terms. The general term, now this is a big deal. This, and you'll get a similar formula when we get into the geometric sequences. This is a very important formula for arithmetic sequences. It's what allows you to quickly set up an expression to get to any term that's in the sequence that you like. Notice that this equation has no place in it that asks for a sub n minus 1. There is a n minus 1, but it's not a subscript, so it's not telling you where you are in the list. This general equation, this general term of an arithmetic sequence will allow you to go to any term in that sequence in one single step. And the general term is a sub n, you know, we're going to describe this arithmetic sequence with a sub n, equals a sub 1, so we're going to start with that first term again, but then plus n minus 1 times d, the number of times, okay, we're adding by the common difference, which could be negative, so you're adding by negative, and we're going to add by that common difference n minus 1 times. Let's just look at this for a second before we move on and actually write the answer. We're at 2. How many times do we have to add to get to 11? The second term, we only add by 9 once. To get to the third term, we only had to add twice. To get to the fourth term, we only have to add 3 times. Like, I teach on the third floor, and students are constantly saying, oh man, those 3 flights of stairs wore me out. You didn't take 3 flights of stairs, you took 2 flights. You were already on the first step. We're already looking first floor. We're already looking at a sub 1. So when you add by 9, or whatever your common difference is, you're not getting to your first term, you're getting to your second term. So thus, to get to the fourth term, you only have to add 3 times. Just like to get to the third floor of my building, you only have to walk up 2 flights of stairs because you're already on the first floor. So that's where this n minus 1 comes from. And our general term is going to be equal to a sub n equals a sub 1, which is 2, plus n minus 1. Again, in a sequence as well, n is that positive integer as a domain. So it's just telling you where you are in the sequence times the common difference of, oh yeah, we were constantly adding by 9. And it would be nice, your teacher may very well, like I, will want you to simplify this expression. So we have 2 plus 9n minus 9, and 2 minus 9 is negative 7, so we have a sub n is equal to 7, or negative 7, plus 9n. All right, let's go look at a couple more examples. Right, the general formula for an arithmetic sequence with a first term of 14 and a common difference of negative 3. Very similar to the previous example, except I wrote it out in sentences without it giving you the actual numbers. So, we're told that it is arithmetic. So as soon as we're told something is arithmetic, we can go ahead and just write that general form out. So we have a sub n equals a sub 1 plus n minus 1 times d. And let's identify the important information and just simply write our answer. The first term of the sequence is 14, so a sub 1 is equal to 14. And the common difference is negative 3. So d equals our negative 3, and we're actually ready to write this answer. A sub 1 is, again, equal to 14, plus n minus 1, and our common difference is negative 3. So we'll put the negative 3 in here, and I get students that write their answers like this very, very commonly, where, you know, it's a sub 1, it's n minus 1, and, you know, there's the d, which is negative 3, but look at what I wrote. That doesn't say n minus 1 times d, that says n minus 1 minus 3. So let's make sure that we wrap that common difference in a set of parentheses, because my book and all the books I've used for arithmetic and geometric sequences, well, we're doing arithmetic right now, but the n minus 1 is always written as the coefficient of d. It might make more sense, actually, if you were to flip it around so that students wouldn't make this, let's call it a sign error, a notation error. And we're going to then take this negative 3, distribute it through the parentheses, just to clean this up a little bit. We got 14, negative 3 times n is negative 3n. And negative 3 times positive 1, negative 1 is positive 3. Now you might notice that I just sort of dropped the parentheses there. There's nothing in front, these parentheses here. There's nothing in front of these parentheses except a plus sign. And I could take that extra step of writing plus and then the negative 3 and the positive 3, negative 3 and the positive 3, but distributing a positive 1 through parentheses are not going to change any values, so it's really just there to highlight the factor of n minus 1, and that positive, just positive 1 in front of the parentheses is not going to change anything as it goes through there. So really these, once you take the d and distribute it through the parentheses, don't need to be there anymore. And we have what? Like terms. We have a 14 and a 3, so we have negative 3n plus 17, and that is our a sub n notation, or our general term of this arithmetic sequence. Let's take a look at one more example, and we'll be done. Last example, express the sum using summation notation. So, I hit these a lot when we go over notes because they're the most thought-provoking problems in these sections that I'm covering right now in precalculus. You can't just completely rely on memorization of formulas to help you out with some of these questions because you're trying to come up with formulas based on, you know, patterns, and that can be a little bit difficult. So we're going to write a summation notation for this, and we're going to have a lower index. We need a lower index. We need an upper index. And of course, ultimately, we need some kind of expression that clearly is going to be a fraction that will create the numbers that are in our sequence here, or series, if you will, that we're going to make the summation notation out of. Okay, let's draw our attention to whatever pattern that we see first. The denominator is increasing by values of 3. Now, you might save that easier pattern for the last thing. You might want to work on the numerator first, but I'm going to go ahead and focus on the first pattern that I see, which is in the denominator, which is I'm seeing negative 5, negative 2, 1, 4, and 7, and then all up to 19. So I'm seeing an arithmetic sequence in the denominator of my values here. So I'm going to go ahead and allow this formula, this general term, of an arithmetic series, or sequence, excuse me, to quickly come up with an answer, an expression that will describe the denominator of these fractions. So a sub n is equal to a sub 1, which is negative 5, and my value of d, I'm constantly adding by the value of 3, so my constant difference is equal to 3. We'll go ahead and distribute this to clean it up a little bit. We have negative 5 plus 3n minus 3. Add like terms, we have a negative 5 and a negative 3, so that's negative 8. Equals 3n. Sorry about the squeak there. So the denominator of my fraction is going to be negative 8 plus 3n. And when you set up your summation notation, you're allowed to have your index, which is going to be described with the letter k. You're allowed to start your index with any integer you like. You can start this at negative 2, 0, 1, 5, whatever you like. But since I'm using my a sub n notation, my general term formula for an arithmetic sequence, excuse me, your domain, your n values are all positive integers. So the lowest value of n that I'm allowed to use, if I'm going to use this formula to help me figure out the denominator, is 1. So I'm going to go ahead and start k with a value of 1 and let it go up. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way up to, yeah, I don't know what that last n value is that I'm going to use for this sequence of numbers. So I'm going to start my lower index at 1, but now I have to figure out what's my upper limit. So to do that, I'm going to erase this and write my a sub n formula out. So a sub n is equal to negative 8 plus 3n. And my last a sub n value, you know, this just tells you where you are in the sequence, but a sub n is the term, and my last term is 19. So I'm going to take out the a sub n, plug in 19, and break my chalk. Okay. And what do we got here? We're going to take the negative 8, and we're going to add it to both sides. And 19 and 8 make 27. Divide both sides by 3. I don't know why I changed colors there. And 9 is equal to n. So my upper limit that I'm going to use in my summation notation is 9. So I'm really getting close to being done with this expression. Well, what's going on with the numerator? In the numerator, I'm multiplying by 1 to get to 1, then I'm multiplying by 2 to get from 1 to 2, then I'm multiplying by 3, and then I'm multiplying by 4, and so on. So I have a pattern in the numerator that is multiplication, and my multiplication values are increasing by values of 1. Well, that's just the opposite of a factorial symbol. 5, or 5 factorial, is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So when you see that multiplication pattern change by values of 1 or decrease by 1 as we go to the left, that is your key or your clue that this is a factorial pattern going on in the numerator. So let's see if we can just put, you know, k factorial. I don't think so. 1 factorial is 1. Oh, okay, that checked out. 2 factorial, though, is not equal to 1. 2 factorial, because we're going to put k factorial or some form of k factorial, 2 factorial is equal to 2. And 3 factorial is equal to 6. And 4 factorial is equal to 24. So this is 1 factorial. This is 2. So when k is 2, we're doing 1 factorial. When k is 3, we're doing 2 factorial. When k is 4, we're doing 3 factorial. And when k is 1, 0 factorial by definition is 1. So this pattern is not k factorial, but it is k minus 1. I'm Mr. True. Bang! Go do your homework. No! I had to get my red chalk out, but I know the camera wouldn't pick it up very well. Anybody notice that I just sort of accidentally went into the variable n and not the variable k? So, everything else I said was right, but I checked my work after I turned the camera off, and I copied the wrong letter. Now, as you do your homework, check your work too. Bye!